really exciting challenge. It's been like the most thrilling video game, like the forgiveness video game that I can imagine. And so I just feel so grateful, and it feels like we've sort of just come through like the eye of the needle, in a sense. That was what Sandy was saying. Like, we've gone through a pretty lot of stuff. It's been pretty intense, and now it's sort of hit, I don't know, some kind of a nice, smooth section of the road where it feels like we're just more connected than we've ever been. So yeah, I'm really excited about this gathering today, and just we've just learned so much about how to relate to each other and how to communicate and how to be really authentic and transparent, and I'm just really excited to share all that with you. So just feel free to ask any questions that come to you, and we'll just be sharing it from our hearts.
I have a question for both of you, and actually would like a separate answer, I mean a distinct answer from each. Do you see a relationship as a special relationship?
Yeah. I mean, I still have, you know, I don't feel like I've totally transcended the ego. And so I do still see it as a special relationship. And for me, it's just about practicing to notice when the specialness creates a conflict, when there's jealousy or fear or whatever. And then that's the opportunity to give it over to the Holy Spirit so He can transform my perceptions into holiness. And so, yeah, for me, it's definitely got a lot of specialness still in my mind, and I'm just working with that and allowing it to be transformed.
Yeah, I think that every relationship we have starts by a special one, and when given to the Holy Spirit, then the purpose can change, and I think that I've been trying so hard to be Eric's wife at the beginning of our marriage, and it has been so painful for me because I was trying to play that role and to be perfect in it. And lately, really, those last month, since I came to the States, actually, I feel that there's been a lot for me, a lot of specialness being undone, and there is still, but I feel that now it depends where I am looking from. When I am totally in the Spirit, I feel there is no specialness, but when I want to do things by myself and that I relate to Armel as being this body and this personality, then there is definitely specialness, yes.
So we're here at your disposal for the next 3 hours. We will, the Spirit, like I said, the fruits of the Spirit comes through in many ways, and it's mainly just a state of mind, but it's many, many forgiveness opportunities that come. And then also, the fruits of the Spirit, we have, like Eric mentioned, songs come. Eric and Armel have been receiving songs. I had a friend named Resta who received about 270 songs from the angels. Helena has received music, variations, and Eric, they actually collaborated. It was kind of like we were in southern Spain, and it was almost like a honeymoon period. And that's when the Holy Spirit started using Eric and Helena for all these collaborations. That was a forgiveness opportunity, right? Nothing like having the Holy Spirit get you married and then say, oh, by the way, I need these two over here to collaborate. You know, like, so it was a big forgiveness lesson. But we do have a lot of beautiful music, really inspiring music that's come through. And so Eric and Armel, in fact, they just had a song come through, was it just very recently?
Yeah, Saturday.
Saturday. Yeah, Saturday we wrote it, and we've just come from Sydney, Australia, but we were down in a place called Mystery Bay and just did this song called Love is Letting Go of Fear, same name as Jerry Jampolsky's book that came through for us to do, so we thought we might do that for you too. So we have a music stand, and I think they've got a little music book there. So it will be a little bit of Q&A and sharing experiences today, and a little bit of sharing the fruits of the Spirit, so you can just sit back and enjoy some beautiful music as well. And for those of you, how many in here know of or have heard of or practice A Course in Miracles? Okay, so I can see there's quite a few, and as you know, this is a pathway to God that definitely emphasizes relationships, using relationships for healing and forgiveness, which is quite different from the traditional ways, like of going off into the caves and the woods and the mountains and living a kind of a very solitary, isolated life where you still practice the same mind training. But the Course in Miracles just, it just brings in the element of mirroring, and that our brothers and sisters are reflecting the thoughts in our mind, and that we can use those for healing.
Hi, my name is Laura. Hello. I'm very new to the Course, and the first question I have goes all the way to that point, that insane thought, or whatever the Course calls it, the bad idea, the what? Whatever, yeah, a bad idea. I'm like stuck at that place trying to figure out how that ever happened. Like it doesn't make sense to me that God, this spirit in perfection, would ever have a momentary thought of separation. Like I'm stuck right there as to how that even happened.
I've been in 26 countries and I've been traveling for 20 years, and I call that the number one asked question. So it's not uncommon at all to have that. In fact, it's intuitively it would be like, how could this ever seem to happen? How could error come out of perfection?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, and I remember when I first picked up the Course in 1986, I was actually out here in California at a humanistic psychology conference down in Southern California with some of the people you may have heard of, Virginia Satir and Francis Vaughn and Roger Walsh and Carl Rogers. Was the last appearance, public appearance that Carl Rogers made, and everyone just gave him a standing ovation that just went on and on for a long time because he was just such a sweetie. And I was drawn, and I came across the Course there, and a book by Ken Wapnick, Forgiveness in Jesus, and a book by Tara Singh, who had a community out here before he passed away, and his book was called Nothing Real Can Be Threatened. Beautiful kind of synopsis of the Course. And I remember with the Course, I used it more like an I Ching, because I would kind of pray and have a question, and I would pop it open for the answer. And I would do that with library books and all kinds of books, not just the Course. But the Course seemed to be particularly helpful at, I formulate the question, I just open it seemingly randomly to any page, and I'm answered as if I'm given a discourse, not just a one-line answer, but actually quite a discourse on the whole thing. It's kind of interesting, it's like having Jesus in your living room. Okay, well, what about this? What about this? So it was quite strong. But actually, the clarification of terms addresses your question, and originally when the Course came in the original material, the clarification of terms was supposed to be at the beginning, but when it was published, they stuck it at the very end of the book. And I thought, that is a little strange. Usually, you know, most books you have the clarification of terms that you're going to be using at the beginning. And when I popped it open, though, I popped it open at the very end, and I actually was reading in the teacher's manual, which is where the clarification of term is. And Jesus says that the ego will ask many questions that this Course has no answer for. How did the impossible happen? To whom did the impossible happen? And many other variations. And he says, an experience will come that will end your doubting. In other words, he says that basically that there are many theologies, and this Course will not attempt to offer a theological answer to how did the impossible happen, or how did the impossible occur. Because in the end, the Course is basically saying that you will have an experience in which all theologies vanish. Absolutely all of them. Every single theology, because theology still is in the realm of concepts and beliefs. And there will come an experience which Jesus calls the atonement, in which you realize that the separation never occurred. So the book is written as if the separation occurred. That's even in the clarification of term. It seems as if you have a split mind. And he puts as if in italics even, you know, because it's really emphasizing, you know, I have to, this book is coming through to reach you where you believe you are. And it's not going to offer some answers to questions because the ego is going to be asking the question, and the purpose of the course is to undo the ego. So in the end you'll have an experience of love that will be so unified and so one that you won't even have a trace of whatever else there seemed to be. It will just be only an awareness of absolute of oneness. So he says in lesson 139, which is, I will accept the atonement for myself, that basically this is the one thing that you need to do. It's the only thing that this world and this life is about, is accepting the correction for the error. And in that correction, you will have an actual experience that there is no ego, and that the separation never occurred. And that is the experience that will come that will end your doubting. He does say also that a universal theology is impossible. And he does imply that in the course, also that he says you forget this world, forget this course, and come with open arms unto your God. So he is implying that even the thought system that he's presenting in the course, even the theology that's being presented, will have to be forgiven and released and dismantled as well. He's like saying there's nothing special about this course, it's just one form of the universal curriculum. He's not giving it some kind of precedent, like it comes from me, so it's the only way. He doesn't ever say, my course is the way, the truth, and the life, and only those who study my course come to God. He doesn't say anything like that. He's like just saying, no, it's just one form of the universal curriculum. It can help you if you give your mind over to it, but you don't even have to believe in God. Belief in God is unnecessary, he says in his psychotherapy pamphlet, for God can be but known. So, to me, that was the answer that I was given, and also I was given, you know, he said, to believe this course, you know, you must question every value that you hold, and he also says, this course will be believed entirely or not at all. So, that sounded a bit like the old uncompromising, you know, teachings that you either fully grasp it or you won't seem to get understand at all what it's talking about. And that is the experience that most students and teachers have with the course. It's dumbfounding, it's confusing, it's at times they find themselves talking back at the book. I've heard people have torn the pages out. One person tore the pages out individually, all 1,200 pages, flushed them down the toilet, crumpled them and flushed them down the toilet. I've gone to other countries, like in Argentina, they said they've heaved the book, hurled the book into the ocean. One group of women in Argentina, they were like, We're trying to study this book, but it's really hard. They said, is there anybody else in the world that's working with this book? Because it's really hard. We don't know if we can handle it. I said, yes, that's a common experience. So I try to let the Holy Spirit just pour through me and make it as practical and straightforward and simple, and also to answer the questions as they're asked very individually. So there's no kind of catch-all kind of answers that you're trying to have for everybody, because everybody's awareness is at a different place of consciousness. So I often have done a lot of one-on-ones, I answer a lot of emails and to Skype chats and on, because it has to come through specifically for the questioner who's asking the question. There's not kind of pat answers, you can't just... God is love. Next question, please. God is love. It doesn't mean anything. You know, it's like that doesn't meet my experience. So, you know, can you give it to me in practical terms? So, it's one of the things I think that we can do up here is, in the context of relationships, in the context of our experiences, is just each answer you from our heart. And I'm glad you got that out of the way. Now you've asked the number one question already, so now we can roll on
To the next 20 questions.
To the next 20 questions. Right, and toward the experience, yes. We're rolling to the experience, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did you already speak about how you and Helena got together? We came in a few minutes late.
No, I didn't. We can talk a little bit about that too.
Thanks.
You want to share?
Yeah, we met in 2005. David, he came to Sweden and held a retreat there. And I could not sleep in the night. It just continued that way. I was just like, ding! Totally lit up for months afterwards. It lasted for, I think, about 3 months. And I was in so much joy, and I had a boyfriend at that time, and he did not study the course, and he didn't really like me talking about God or anything. He didn't want to hear, like, no, I don't want to hear it. So I was guided to leave that relationship, and also I felt it was coming in to start traveling with David. He invited me to go on a Europe tour then. It was in 2007. It came a little bit later. We had actually met several times in Sweden as well before that. And I just went to every retreat that he came to in Sweden. And every time it was just this ding kind of feeling, like, oh my God, this is just so it. The practical application of the course, of really taking the steps of undoing everything that you thought were of this world. And actually one time when he came afterwards, I went to the subway station, and it was this revelatory experience of just total love that was just not connected to anything or anyone. It was just this experience just coming to me, and I was just crying and crying and crying and crying, and I could just so feel it, like, if this is it, if this is just a fraction of what it's about, I'm totally going for it. And it was so beautiful that it was like coming, a bit of that experience came like twice after that. And it was this connection that just came. I was at one retreat, David wasn't there at that time, but I was just talking about the experience and it was coming to me, and it just came, David came into my mind as well with that. And
Can I come in as a horse a couple times?
Yeah, it was one time I was dreaming, and I was riding this white horse, and we were flying up in the air, and I was moving around, you know, like resistance to the joining, because the ego is so afraid, it knows that it's its undoing, so it's like totally scary. And so I was moving around on the horse and just resistance, you know, and we came down to the ground because we couldn't fly with the resistance. And so we came down to the ground, and the horse was saying, Helena, why are you moving? And yeah, that was coming in a period when I had resistance coming up, and it was just really frightening, and it was just coming in as a symbol at that time that it was, no, I'm still to be with you. And it's just this reassurance that of what the guidance had been before, because also in the beginning it was just similar to Eric and Amel. We had met though, but I could only see him as Jesus. I didn't see him as a man. And we started talking about over Skype, over like using the symbol of engagement. So we had never kissed, and we had not actually. Yeah, we were on different continents at that time, and I got the guidance to put on the ring that I had used in my former relationship with the guy that I told you about before, and so I just put the ring on, and I just went out walking with my dogs, and I had not even talked to David. We had just talked about it, and I was just like, okay, I'll just try it out then. I'll just put on the ring, because really it's like the decision for union with God, like oneness, like the circle that is never broken, but it's just like that you dedicated to just knowing that you are it, and just use it with the backdrop of relationships, which is just flushing away everything, like we talked about before here. And so, yes, I put on the ring, and I was just walking out there with my dogs, and the dogs, they were just doing all these things that they did not normally do.
like diving into the grass. Like all of a sudden they were just diving into the grass. And I was like, oh man, that's funny. And it just came to me, just dive right in. So it was just like this, like that. And then it was like this other simple, it was this bench that was just moved every day when I was walking the dogs. I lived on this island and it was like this bench that always, you know, it was moved. Every time I saw it, it was moved by someone. And this day it was down by this fireplace. And David Eve sent me this song that was called Eternal Flame, which is, of course, the flame with God, the burning love that is always there for us. And at this fireplace, it was a left-hand glove. That day, a left-hand glove. It was like left. Okay, normally you have like, you know, your engagement or wedding ring on the left-hand side. And it was there, laying there, right at the fireplace. And I was like, okay, there's another one. And this bench was right there at the fireplace. And it was actually moving back towards, the back was like facing towards the fireplace. It was kind of like showing that, no, this is not any specialness, but it is facing the water, which is, to me, it was like a huge symbol for the Holy Spirit, that it's all focused on the guidance, and that's kind of pull you through of everything that you have put up as a defense for the specialness. So it was this beautiful thing. So when we came to the Skype, then I told David, like, okay, I put on the ring. So it was like this whole different way of, you know, doing it. And then when we came together, when he came to Sweden, then I could kiss him for the first time after we were engaged, actually. So it was...
Oh, there's a commonality. It's all backwards.
Yeah.
Everything out of order. Lots of things are
backwards. The world's backwards.
Yeah.
Spirits
the world's backwards and upside down.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the other thing, too, it's just all the symbols, like for Eric and Armel, the tattooed rings, in fact, it's just the top part there of your fingers, right? So you have to actually have your hands together to have the circle complete.
Yeah.
There's some beautiful symbols that I never heard about. There it is. The two.
It doesn't really come all the way.
Yeah.
You can imagine.
You can imagine how it works, but and also, I think for them the legal marriage was very important. In fact, Armel probably wouldn't be sitting here in this seat if it wasn't for that legal marriage. And with Helen and I, it's like I've been like a traveling mystic for many years, starting back in 1991. And so by the time I first met her, it was 2005, and by the time we came together to start traveling together, it was 2007. But you might have heard of like off the grid. Mystics are off the grid, way off the grid. And so far off the grid that I've just been living on Divine Providence, doing gatherings, you know, based on love offerings, living a very simple life instead of living at the Sheraton or the Holiday Inn and using planes. I was using, mostly in the United States and some parts of Canada, but I was using a little three-cylinder car, Chevy Sprint, back when the gasoline was like maybe a dollar a gallon, and the car got like 40-some miles a gallon. So the donations went pretty far, you know. Dinner time was go into your local grocery store, get a loaf of French bread for a buck, get a can of Hunt's spaghetti sauce. There you go. Prime feast. Keep dipping that long. If you're really hungry, you know, a loaf of French bread and a can of spaghetti sauce goes a long way. You know? For like $2, you can have a royal feast. So by the time I met Helena, you know, I've been living a very kind of mystical life. They talk about poverty level. My income didn't come close to the poverty level. Income tax, I was living so simply. People had homes and houses, offerings of rides. Oh, come stay here. Here's a ride. We're taking my little three-cylinder car and scooting all over the place for very little money, living very, very simply. And by the time I had met Helena, I had just begun with the world travels in 2003. So that began with people offering me frequent flyer miles. I was offered frequent flyer miles, and I actually was flown first class, Ejecutiva, they call it in Spanish, down to Argentina. by a man named David, who had won a contest for Latin America Airlines. If you go stay at these hotels, and you stay at these, fly these airlines, then you could win, the grand prize, he told me, was 1 million frequent flyer miles. And he said, I won the prize. So I've got all these frequent flyer miles. So you see how divine providence works with overseas travel. You meet somebody that you've never met before, and they say, you should take this message overseas, and I've got 1 million frequent flyer miles, and I'd like to go with you and fly 2 more people with you. So that's how the world travels there.
Mm-hmm. That's one question. You're talking about colleague relationships, right? I think in my case, I started with this course in 2008. I think after that, I was definitely having problems, you know, finding out my way. I guess it's really hard to really be consistent, probably, with the course. In June 2009, I met a person overseas. I'm originally from Peru. My ex-girlfriend was from Colombia. And anyway, I just took the relationship because I thought it was going to be, you know, part of my guidance, I'd say. Well, it started really well, of course. A year after, when I talked to her about the course, everything changed. You know, it's, I guess from my part, I was probably having expectations of what I wanted in the relationship. But I noticed that when I talked to her about my experience with the course, things changed dramatically. And of course, you know, we spent Christmas together last year. As you said, as you have mentioned, I also do the same question in order to work. And I ask the Holy Spirit to give me guidance. And in Christmas, I opened chapter 15, and he talks about Christmas. And there was a note right there, pretty much telling me to let it go. So I did. It was hard, definitely, because you believe that you still love that person. But at the same time, we were far away from each other. And I don't know. Since I talked to her about the course, and I felt like she wasn't following, I was completely, you know, like, probably untrustful about the whole thing. And anyway, I'm here now, just, you know, trying to understand, you know, what's happening.
Yeah, I find that that it's not so much the form of things, but it's like, as you go deeper into your spiritual journey, it's like the relationships that are sent to you, that are orchestrated, part of your awakening, are, they become very, very, I call them like vibrational relationships. And, you know, some people will say, you know, we're on the same page or we're not on the same page. I find that every relationship is helpful. Even, we were talking right before we came in about the 3 levels of relationship that Jesus talks about, the casual encounter and then the fairly intense teaching learning situation where you appear to separate or seem to separate, and then the lifelong relationship. But he prefaces even those categories by saying, you know, really there are no levels in God's plan, and that basically every single encounter that you have is an opportunity to fully experience enlightenment and salvation. You could do it in any relationship. You could do it when you're at the grocery store or stopping to get some gas with the attendant you're paying or whatever, that every single relationship is an opportunity, and he calls it a holy encounter. You know, when you meet anyone, remember it's a holy encounter. As you see him, you will see yourself. As you treat him, you will treat yourself. As you think of him, you will think of yourself. And then he says, never forget this, for in him you will find yourself or lose yourself. So that sounds a bit like the Bible, you know, take the stranger in. If you think you have an enemy, you don't. It's just the filter in your mind that needs to be cleared, and, you know, take the speck out of your, or take the beam out of your own eye before you take the speck out of your brother's eye. It's totally your perception that has to shift, and it has nothing to do about projecting, blaming, scapegoating. So, in one sense, in terms of relationships, I think you do, you really have to follow your guidance, and if you find yourself in a relationship that it may involve hostilities and difficulties and so on and so forth, all relationships do, you know, as Eric and Armel were saying, they all start special, so that shouldn't be unusual. But in terms of a deep vibrational connection, in terms of what your shared purpose is, like, I would say that is really important in these deep, long-term vibrational relationships. You could call it forgiveness, you could call it peace of mind, you could, something like that. But in one sense, it has to kind of shake down that the priority in the relationship is this higher goal. If you've got a desire for peace of mind or forgiveness, and your partner, you know, wants a big house in such and such, or children, or all the other things that this world seems to offer, it's really, the Course is saying that peace has to be number one. You could call it whatever you want. It doesn't give you any special names. You know, people call it by many different names. It could be tranquility, or freedom, or love, or happiness. You know, it can go by many different names. But I remember when I was first reading the Course, and I read that passage, the peace of God is my one goal, the aim of all my living here, the end I seek, my purpose, and my function, and my life, while I abide where I am not at home. I thought, wow, if I ever have a partner in the sense of a living together and sharing together, it really would be helpful if we shared the same goal, because so much darkness is going to come up that if we don't have kind of a superordinate or a higher goal that we both really come back to, then it feels like the relationship will just disintegrate. It will seem to break up almost like a spaceship entering the Earth's atmosphere. All the heat from the undoing will just burn the thing up unless there's a shared purpose. So I think really what I hear from you is it has been really a lesson in discernment for you, and you do have a calling in your heart, and if you do feel like a partnership is part of that,